before I actually get to talk, I'd like to thank, on behalf of all of us, I think, Luca and Julian and all of the organisers of the workshop for all of the good work that they've done, and I'd like to thank you for being such a fantastic audience at the end of the year. And as I said, I'm glad to be in a position where I'm the only thing between you and beer and lunch and things. So there's no constraints. So I can go for as long as I like. This is kind of oh dear. Oh dear, sorry. You've got a hand up in case you want to fall asleep and need to catch back up or anything like that. There's more stuff that's in the handout that I'm not going to be talking about, and there's lots of references in case things up. So my aim in this talk is to try and get a better understanding of speech acts of assertion and denial and their relationships to other speech acts, and connections between the speech acts that I'm looking at and multiple couplets. I'm not a linguist. I'm not going to be talking about semantics and natural language expressions. Really interested in semantics and natural language expressions, but I'm also a logician who is trying to understand how the kinds of things that I do when I do logic actually work, and the way that information is transmitted and connected, and the way that concepts can be defined in the way that logicians do. And that's actually going to be my focus. The particular prompt for doing this here is that I want to revisit some scenes and expand on some claims that I made in the 2005 paper. Multiple conclusions that a number of people have talked about. But also, you invited me to this workshop and I had to have something to say. And this seemed like the best audience for doing some of this work. So the focus is going to be behavior of two kinds of speech acts, in addition to assertion and denial, polar questions or yes no questions, and justification requests. So I'm going to use attention to those things to clarify and respond to two issues that people have had with the approach that I developed in that paper. So here's the outline of the rest of the talk. We're going to talk about assertion and denial. We're going to talk about polar questions. And that's the first half. Then I'm going to talk about positions and rules. And then I'm going to talk about justification requests. And that's the end. And then you'll all say, yes, that's great. Let's go ahead. Okay, assertion and denial. Sequence, bunch of formulas on the left, bunch of formulas on the right, bunch of statements. And the line that I took in multiple conclusions was that this was basically enjoining us to not assert each member of X and deny each member of Y, or not accept each member of X and reject each member of Y. And that's really interesting. And I think that when you take that sort of perspective on getting some multiple premise, multiple conclusion sequel calculus, you get a nice insight into the behavior of the structural rules and the connected rules of sequel calculus. I like paying attention to the structural rules because how I got into logic was in a very focused sort of substructural objects where you pay attention to the behavior of these structural rules. My favorite structural rule that I spent a lot of time talking about was the rule of contraction, and this plays no role here. Because we're thinking of the X's and the Y's as just collections of sets, and so whether things repeat or not makes no difference. So far, we'll see this in the last section, where return and rear its very elegant and interesting head. The structure of rules play a great deal of a role in the calculus. For me, are the structural rules of identity, which here has got some weakening in it, and the structural rule of caste. And what distinguishes these from the connected rules is that these govern assertions, denials, contents as such, rather than focusing on the behavior of any particular sort of content. And so if you've got that reading of the sequence, the identity structural rule says two things. It not only says don't assert A and deny A, but it also says that that kind of stands in any context where you've made up an assertion. So whatever kind of don't this is, it's not the kind of don't which you can get out of by making more commitments. It's not the kind of, you know, this doesn't really make sense to say this, but you can explain. mind of the attention of why you are saying more. No, the clash between assertion and denial is pretty bad, and it's going to stay there. The only way to get rid of it is to retract one of those things. And then the couple come to say this. One way of thinking about this is that it's a position that I'm mentioning below the line, where I assert all that X is a denial of the lies. If that's okay, then either asserting A is not going to take you out of bounds, or denying A is not going to take you out of bounds. I'll say more about that later. People have had lots of interesting things to say about the costs and benefits of it, but you can see it as a kind of non-condition. But every kind of claim, if it's undeniable, then asserting it is going to just make explicit commitments that people deny. Okay. Now, logical concepts can be given rules which, at this point, these aren't Gans's original rules for logical concepts, but conjunction, disjunction, negation, conditional quantifiers, and identity. But these are equivalent to Gans's rules under a certain guise. I like this double line rule, which you might have seen in, you know, Danny Scott's work or Christian Ocean's work as well. I like this because if you think of this in a broadly normative, pragmatic sort of way, the kind of way that, you know, Brandt or Dummett or other people might have, that these languages and communicative practices and norm-governed practices, then we can think of defining something like conjunction in the first rule, top left. We can think of that as saying, well, I'm going to tell you something about the norms governing the use of a conjunction in terms of the norms governing its components. So to assert a conjunction takes you out of bounds in any context, if and only if a certain verb of the conjunct takes you out of bounds in that context. And that if and only is what makes that a definition, that's what makes it not aligned at all. You know, you get from one thing up in either direction. Double line becomes. And then, you know, denying a disjunction has got the same force with respect to the bounds as denying both disjuncts. Asserting a negation has the same force as denying the thing negated, denying a material conditional, asserting the antecedent, denying the consequent, denying the universal qualifier, that's out of bounds if denying an arbitrary instance is out of bounds. Right, what's an arbitrary instance? It's giving a fresh singular term, eigenvariable if you like. Asserting an existential qualifier out of bounds when you can't assert it for an arbitrary instance, and denying an identity is out of bounds if it's out of bounds to distinguish things in the same identity. What would be the point to deny its identity? So, lots of things that you can say about those things, but it's nice and uniform, and some work that I've been doing more recently, and there's a 2019 paper that I cited. Bibliography, which goes through this for the connectives and quantifiers, is that there's a nice uniform way of showing that Gensen's original left-right rules are sort of interdividable with these double-line rules, and that anything which can be given a double-line rule like this, of this structure, is uniquely defined and conservatively extended because the conditions are getting a couple of shaky sort of there in the line. That's a lovely element. And can be understood in terms of, imagine I've got to practice without and. Well, here's one thing that you can do to extend your practice, to have and. Treat an assertion of the conjunction as out of bounds just when the assertions of both of the contracts are out of bounds, etc. Now, you might say, well, that doesn't tell me anything about how to treat the denial of conjunction. Well, it's the identity of the couples which tell you how assertions and denial are connected and get the rule to the other side out of it. And of course, you know, the denial of a conjunction cannot also be reduced to the denial of other things. The point of extending your practice is to be able to do things that you couldn't do otherwise. You know, one side's going to be defined and the other side isn't. That's the point. Okay, so that's the picture. Now, in the picture of multiple conclusions, I just said stuff about assertion and denial. And when I was appealing to norms and bounds and clashes and assertion and stuff like this, I was wading into a very large literature. I was aware of literature, I just didn't care about addressing much of it because because I'm just talking about things being out of bounds, I'm just not talking about the other things that people talk about, the norms of assertions. But of course, lots of people have said really interesting things about the norms of assertion, and I think it's worth paying attention to them. It's fruitful to think of assertion as the kind of act which is rule-governed, and governed and evaluated appropriately by a whole range of norms. So I think that when you think about the norms of assertion, one way of thinking about this is in three different perspectives. If you think of a speech act as something which involves a speaker and a hearer, then you've got norms which govern the speaker, and that's me, because I'm speaking this way. And then there's norms which govern the hearer, and that's you. And then there's norms which govern us, the kind of space in which we're a part. So the norms for me are kind of production norms, because I'm the person producing all these things. And, you know, some people would say that, well, one norm for speaking is to say what's true. That's the job of the social claiming that something's true. Hey, to say what's true. Or other people say a really important norm is to say what you know. In fact, some of us think that both of these kind of govern assertion in different sorts of ways, that an assertion can be incorrect in one way if it's not true, and it can also be bad in another way if it was an expression of something which happened to be true, but I was kind of fluky in saying it's appropriate to evaluate it along both of these axes. Another important thing, of course, is that if you sort of get back to me about this, I'm kind of required to back up what I've said in some way. Exactly how that works is another question, but that's another norm which is required of me. You can see how there might be connections between these things. Philosophers love arguing about which of these is more fundamental than the other ones. I'm a logician, I don't care about that right now. There's also norms for you, which are connected to the norms for me. One of the norms for you might be that you're entitled to reassert this, in general, feasible, you're entitled to reassert the thing that I've asserted. This is something which distinguishes norms from commands. For example, if I tell a graduate student to get their thesis on time, you can tell the graduate student to get their thesis on time. It's not going to be a command in the sense of why. Or if I tell a graduate student, get certain. And actually another thing which is kind of close to an assertion that is not an assertion, was not merely an assertion, it's an observative. If I, see a rabbit and say, hello, a rabbit, and if Dave wants to repeat what I said, if he didn't see the rabbit, it would be inappropriate for him to say, no, the rabbit, because he's not seeing the rabbit. But he could repeat, Greg saw a rabbit, or there's a rabbit there, or something else like that. In the same way, the difference between ouch and that, so there's a whole bunch of different ways that you can characterize these things. But one thing that seems to distinguish assertion is that you're entitled to reassert. And in particular, when you do that, you're incurring an obligation to justify things. But the nice thing about it is you can pass it on to them if you're reasserting the right. And one way of thinking about how these things fit together is that to assert is to be able to the content asserted to be able to interpret a lot of stuff. Like that. This is the body of information that we together for the sake of the conversation that's taking place. Here's a nice quote from Stolnacker on what the common ground is, and you all know it. Okay, now in multiple conclusions, I was distinguishing assertion and denial and saying that these were bilaterally appropriately connected. And I said a little beyond the claim that assertion and denial are incompatible, so it's useful to like that, but not a lot. In particular, that they were incompatible in some sense. Now, this doesn't help distinguish denial from attraction and other things like that. And it's important for me to do that. So I'm going to do it. I'm going to do this by turning to polar questions and answers to polar questions in the light of our background interest in social networks. So we're already in the next section. Polar question. Polar question has the form, is it a case of effect? Hey, what about that? It's a speech act with its own norms, and it raises an issue. It's an issue on the questions under the discussion stack. And there's two ways, in general, to settle an issue, with a yes-type answer or a no-type answer. I mean, one way to do the, a yes-type answer is to sort of echo the form of the question asymptotically, and the word. wait a second. Did settle the issues positively and negatively? I asked him, you know, is that how we got into the power? And you say yes. And that settles the issue positively. These are the posts. Or it's a bid to settle the issue positively. Or if you say no, and that settles the issue negatively. If you say, well, what if I know, I don't know, then the issue's still open. But if I say yes, and you say no, it's the one and the same poll question, then we disagree. We're taking different stances. And there's no shared position. It takes both of that perspectives. It takes both of our perspectives as given. There's going to be other, you know, positions which might take aspects of both of our perspectives into account. But this is why I say, you know, do you stand vacuating and saying that yes in this sense to you, and yes in that sense to you? But one way of understanding the role of disambiguation is that we use this as a kind of norm for characterizing what content is. Why is it that when I say I'm standing, yes, and Dave says I'm standing, no, that you can agree with both of us? Well, we're saying something different because we're using the word I, you know, to refer to ourselves, and so that's the context. So, yeah, there's more to be said. But important to say that other responses to poll questions like me, I don't know, I think so, are acceptable response. They're acceptable conversational responses to me. They're not changing the topic, but they don't answer the question. They don't say it. Now, the neat thing about this is if you have in mind whatever people say about the norms governing assertion, it seems like settling answers to questions, to poll questions. They are, you know, constrained by the same sorts of norms. You know, if I lie, or if I lie and say something that I believe not to be the case, or if I say yes when I believe that the right answer to it is no, or if I say yes and the correct answer is no, then I've made a mistake in different sorts of ways. I'm adding to the common ground. I'm entitling you to answer the question in the same sort of way. That can come to me. So counts as an assertion. So we've got this more specific speech act, which is a kind of a more general speech act. Now, this immediately raises the question, what does a no answer to the poll question be assert? It's an assertion, so presumably it asserts something. What does it assert? You could say it asserts nothing, and I don't think you'd be wrong. But I prefer of thinking about this in general by drawing that from the fact that every assertion is not contained in asserts. Say, no, well, what we want a more general way of thinking about things is that some assertions assert P, and some things count as assertions, but they're denials of that content. So denial can count as an assertion in a general sense of something, you know, adding the common ground being constrained by those sorts of norms. But I prefer to think of a yes to P. A yes to the poll question B as moving P in, and a no to the poll question B as moving P out. So that assertion is denials. But the reason for that is not because I think that the content that's asserted is not appropriately called, not P. I'm very happy to say that. But I prefer to think instead of keeping track for particular sort of communicative practices, track of what the contents are that these little critics can assert and deny and engage in. And say that, well, maybe you might get some credit and try to say yes or no to things, but if you formed a question for them where the question itself was a negation, they might not know how to do that because they don't yet have a, you know, composable embeddable negation in their vocabulary. But that's nothing is going to stand and hang on that for the purposes of the discussion that we're going on to, but it's just sort of explaining the going in this direction, because I'm interested in the behavior of vocabularies where we've got limited expressive resources and we're then extending them by adding new expressive resources. Because I'm really interested in what am I doing when I'm using particular sorts of rules to define logical concepts. I'm looking at the transition between a vocabulary where I've got no logical concepts and I'm adding them to them, including negation. So I don't want to take negation as a part of what my contents are closed up at the beginning. But nothing important for the rest of this discussion actually hangs on that. Okay, but that perspective, I'm going to think of the common ground not in the installed accurate sense of said as it possibly was, although common ground can be modeled in that sense, but I'm going to think about it in a more general kind of conversational story, where we think of the common ground so far as the things that we've ruled in and the things that we've ruled out. Pair of sets of sentences. We've ruled in everything that's in X, call that the positive common ground. We've ruled out everything that's in Y, call that the negative common ground. And so think of this as a conversational scoreboard. And that's one aspect of the conversational scoreboard. Think of cases where we're having a conversation, we've said a whole bunch of stuff, and we've agreed to disagree about something. So it's actually a conversational record. Here's where we're agreed. The things that we've granted together, and then there's some extra commitments that I've incurred that you haven't, and extra commitments that you've incurred that I haven't, and in particular in cases where we've agreed to disagree with the passion loss. But then, you know, conversational scoreboards will have you more than that, questions and discussion, various sorts of discourse references, a whole bunch of things that comes on in conversation. So I don't want to say that the common ground, as it were, is all that we're shifting in discussions, we're keeping track of things. And one thing that I'm doing when I'm asserting conversationally, you know, I'm offering something as an addition to the conversation. Which doesn't mean that I'm offering it to you as your belief or anything like that. I could be asking you to engage in a conversation with me to try some stuff on, even though I know that you radically disagree with a whole bunch of things, but I just want to get your feedback and I want you to, suppose this is, you know, take a bunch of things for granted for me for the sake of this conversation. So let's talk about denial and the difference between denial and retraction. And I'm not going to be talking about Alison, Bob, and Ted, and Carol. I'm going to be talking about Adela and Louise, because that's how we do it. There's a footnote, obvious, you know, required footnote, saying that when you're bringing up obvious cases of academic sexual harassment, the intervention these things in the case of MeToo, and the current cultural climate. So there it is. Who knows about the relationship between Adela and Louise? There's lots of things you can read about that. But they got a kid, Aspen. And that, yes, that's how you step his name. Now, imagine Adela and Eloise trying to look for that Aspenade. And Adela says, Aspenade didn't study. And Eloise says, no, he's in the kitchen. That's clearly a denial in some sense, but that's fine. And here's the obvious disjunction case that we all love talking about here. Adelaide says, Astrolabe's in the study, and Eloise says, no, he's either in the study or in the kitchen. You know, imagine that they're engaging in a joint search, and they've exhausted everything. They've checked everywhere in the house except the study and the kitchen, and because Adelaide forgets about the existence of the kitchen, because he's that kind of guy, just concluded that Astrolabe is in the study, and Eloise correct. Now, he's in the study or kitchen. Okay, now, try to figure out what's going on in these cases. Are those two nodes the same? Are those two nodes similar? Are those two nodes different? What's going on? What kind of speech act is that node? Well, that node is not an answer to a question, because Adelaide is not asking it. But if you phrase it as a question, you get interesting distinctions. If Adelaide says, is Adelaide in the study? Eloise says, no, he's in the kitchen. Then she's settling the answer negatively. No. She could have just said, is Adelaide in the study? And Eloise could have just said, no. And then you figure out where it is. It's your son. Why do I say? Make various assumptions about what this means about my domestic home life, but that's outdated. It's a long time. So this is the appropriate denial, settling negative answer to the whole question. But notice it's kind of different in the disjunctive case, where, you know, is Astrolabe in the study, and they've been doing the joint search. She can't say no, he's either in the study or in the kitchen, unless she's also giving him a logic lesson. And wanting him to, you know, do a disjunctive sentence. That is a way of understanding. You could say, is Astrolabe in the study? No, but he's either you're in the study and the kitchen, or in the kitchen, you figure it out along. But if the epistemic state, or if the conversational status are, which are everywhere except for those two places, then the appropriate thing for those studies may be, or something like that, is either in the study or in the kitchen. So I reckon it's clear this, I'm going to call this a strong remark. Knowing the professor, because she is settling the question negatively. And I'm going to call that a strong remark in the case of where it's a response to the assertion, too, because it's the same sort of response. Okay. But in the maybe case, what Eloise is giving is a partial answer. And so I'm going to call this weak, weak speech acts, this is all the rage around here, especially. And I think this is totally right. This is totally right thing to say. There's something denying that's going on. She's denying it's fine. But what she's not doing is settling the issue negatively. She's denying that claim. So I think to strongly deny, and how do I distinguish strong and weak denial? Well, at a first cut to this, strong denial is meant to add things to the negative compound. So, whereas the weakly denied is to block the addition of P to the positive common ground, or to bid for its retraction that's already there. He's put in a bid for this, and maybe you can imagine Aspilates in the study, and Ellen's immediately says, no, he's either in the study or the kitchen. So then there's no sense in which Aspilates in the study is in the common ground frame at the time, because he's blocking the addition immediately. But you can imagine it's a really big house. Something like that. And, you know, Eloise knows. And they're progressing in that direction. But before they started searching the study, the light, you know, dawns on her. She says, no, he's either in the study or in the kitchen. Something like that. So that's what I think, that it's been in the common ground for a little while, and they're acting on that basis, heading in that direction, and then she puts my bid for a subtraction. Okay, so I think that's one way of understanding the difference between the two chapters. So strong or weak denials of P are appropriate responses to the assertion of P, because the assertion of P is either, you know, putting the thing in the common ground or a bid for the thing to be in the common ground. And so either, you know, trying to oppose that, if you've got other information, say no, and saying something's not bad, or say no, let's get that out of there, it shouldn't be there. That's a totally appropriate response. But we've got an explanation of why you've got differential responses in the question answer case. Because a strong denial is totally appropriate as an answer to the polar question, because it's just settling it negatively, whereas a weak denial is never an appropriate response to a polar question, because the polar question itself took the issue out of the common ground. You wouldn't even ask it if it wasn't an issue to be settled. So there's no way that the weak denial is appropriate in that case. It's not there to block up the ground. So, well, as we saw in Maria's talk, you know, where you've got three things, you've most often got four if you've got two distinctions. Strong denial is adding to the negative common ground, strong assertion is adding to the positive common ground, weak denial is retracting or blocking from the negative of the positive common ground. So obviously it's got to have weak assertion, which is retracting or blocking from the negative. Now, we've been ruling this out. Perhaps. You know, Julian and Luca. And we have been doing, you know, interesting work on this stuff. But this is the way that I'm going to understand the relationship between assertion and denial in this sort of framework, and how to distinguish strong denial from other negative speech acts. But I think this has got some consequences, especially for somebody like me, who's interested in the behavior of the logical concepts, and the behavior of proof and reasoning and inference, which is one of the things that people have been taking me to task for, that multiple conclusions is an approach doesn't directly give a correct understanding of the texture and the structure of deduction and inference. And this is now I'm going to explain why taking the common ground as a set of worlds for when you're interested in these sorts of distinctions is a too coarse level of analysis to understand all the kind of conversational moves that we're having. So, Abelard has been tutored by Eloise in geometry. Abelard's, you know, got his first triangle, he's reasoning about it, and he's figured out that the interior angles of this triangle are 40, 60, and 80 degrees. He adds up the angles and notices that they sum up to 180 degrees. And so Abel, being the smart guy that he is, says, ah, the interior angles of triangles add up to 180 degrees. And Eloise says, no, the interior angles of this triangle add up to 180 degrees. Can you prove the general case? This seems to be exactly the same as the searching the house case, where he's, you know, being a bloke and has generalized from a very specific case and has gone beyond his epistemic bounds, as it were. Eloise seems to block from the common ground and weakly deny something which is actually, as a matter of fact, a logical consequence of the claims that they've all got.
The axioms of geometry.
That's what they recite, the axioms of Euclid, together with a little bit of arithmetic and everything every time. Put them in the common ground. Very, very ritualistic geometry. So this, you know, Eloise, the thing that Eloise is weakly denying, you know, here's something that she grants, but she's not going to grant it to him now. He's got to think of that. And that looks to me like a weak denial, a retraction from the common ground. This would be impossible if the common ground was hit. Now, which isn't to say that looking at it at that level of analysis isn't fruitful and interesting in every day. But it's not. I mean, fruitful and interesting for many things. But this looks to me just as much as it is. And it's not, you know, she's not talking about the words. She's talking about interior angles of triangles and things like that. So just going sort of meddling with it, saying that she's talking about the thing rather than the facts. I think that's not right. So connection between multiple consequence and denial of assertion, I think that analysis that I gave in multiple conclusions and the one that I still stand by is that if sequence is derivable, then it's evidence to strongly assert each member of the left and strongly deny each member of the left. Member of the left and member of the right. But this example, I think, shows that it need not be unbalanced, that strongly assert each member of the left-hand side of it, and weakly deny all of the members of the right-hand side. That's why it is simple. Eloise knows that this is a logical consequence, that the general theorem is a logical consequence of the commitment to that more strongly asserted. She's still weakly denied, as inappropriate to assert in this context. But he hasn't proved it yet. There's more to be said about that. They were. Okay, so to remind you what I said about positions. Position is what, you know, these common ground things are examples of positions. Packages of assertions and denials. And any package of assertions and denials where something's both asserted and denied is out of bounds, that's the identity rule, and a couple can be understood like this. Let's say that something which is not out of bounds is available. Then the couple, like I said, says that if the position X and Y is available, then if one way to settle A is not available, then the other way to settle A is available. Namely, it's already the commitment that you're making explicit what was implicit. And yeah, lots of very, very smart people I respect don't think that this is always correct in case of quandaries, and so I refer them back to, you know, now, when Mino says, just Socrates, that's undeniable Socrates. He's not saying, well, it's undeniable, but I might be changing anyway. No, when he's saying something's undeniable, that's actually a stronger claim than it's undeniable. Okay. So, using these positions, I'm now going to go back to the logical constants and their rules. So, you look at these defining rules for things like the propositional connectors, kind of elegant and beautiful, and everybody should. But in particular, I think of them as definitions. They show you how to treat assertions or denials of a defined concept in terms of assertions or denials of their components. And I don't offer these as ways of thinking that all kinds of semantic problems need to be given like this. This might be a story about what's kind of special about things like this. They're kind of subject-neutral and structural and merely expressive of the kinds of, you know, practice of assertion and denial that we kind of engage in. Maybe you could say that. Maybe that doesn't work out. I don't know. Let's just explore and see how it works. But these are very special sorts of rules. with them, you can compose them, chain them together, and make them with derivations. This kind of tells you, P or not P is always, it's always out of balance to rely on P or not P. Because, so at the top it's the identity sequence, asserting not P and denying not P is out of balance. Asserting not P has got exactly the same consequence to the bounds as denying P. And denying P and denying not P has got exactly the same consequences to the bounds as denying P or not P. So if you're an intuitionist and you think that denying P or not P is sometimes okay, then you disagree with one of these rules. You don't, the concepts that you're using are not governed by those rules. Or you don't actually think that P or not P is undeniable. What you think that P or not P is not provable, what you might mean is something else. So it gives you a kind of way to access that. And similarly, equal opportunity, disagreeing with my logical friends. Not only do I disagree with constructivists in Amsterdam, I disagree with dialetics in Melbourne and say that it's never, it's always out of bounds, there's no contradiction, but exactly the reasons. Now, when you do this, very smart people, we saw some quotes. Very smart people said these sorts of things where you go, oh, what's crap going on the right hand side? They don't look like groups. Well, it's not the textbooks look like that. But anyway, these things don't have the same shape as groups. In particular, where is the conclusion in something which has got two of the things on the right hand side? That doesn't look like a conclusion to me. That doesn't look like very precise. It looks like you've got options. So, and here's the thing that Dave was talking about. That in sequence, if I derive something which manages to have one thing on the right-hand side, it doesn't tell me to infer A from S. It merely tells me to not assert all the members of X and deny A. And just as A is undeniable in the context in which the X is asserted, it doesn't seem to be telling me to do anything. And so that's another issue too. So I'm going to make this problem sharp. It's a quote, I'll just cut and paste a passage from the dialogue between Achilles and Achilles. I'm not going to read it all out, you all know it. If you don't, you can read it, it's in the handout. But Achilles is trying to do some deductions from geometry with the tortoise, and to simplify things a little bit, Achilles says, A, and if A, then Z, and it follows from that and Z. And the tortoise says, I grant you that A, and I grant you that if A, then Z. But can you tell me why Z follows from that? And Achilles, being ever so helpful, says, well, let me tell you why A and Z follows from that. Here's what's true. A, and A implies Z. And I don't know if you've noticed, but if I and if I am not Z, then Z. So it follows from all of that, that Z. And the tortoise, being ever so, tortoise, says, oh yeah, I grant you that. I grant you that, then I, and if I, then Z. Oh, by the way, if I and if I, then Z, then Z. But could you tell me why Z follows? And Achilles, being ever so helpful, says, well, let me tell you, I am Fred and Zed, and I am Fred and Zed, and Zed. And, oh, by the way, if I and if I then Zed, and I and if I then Zed, then Zed, if all of that, then Zed, etc. And the dog then finishes. This is a problem for me, if you think of the talk as being a bit of a dick, because he is not respecting some norms of dialogue, which are not merely pragmatic, don't you think, norms, but something else. Because for me, the tortoise never asserts the premises and denies the conclusion. Notice that establishing that the tortoise has permission to assert that also doesn't answer the question. Because the tortoise is not asking for permission to assert Z. It's not like he's jumping at the bit saying, tell me why I can assert Z, why it's safe, or anything like that. That still doesn't answer the question. The tortoise doesn't know why it should. the tortoise is asking for is a justification request. That's a different thing. Okay, what's a justification request? Taking this back to our family and friends, Abelard says, that's the way to the kitchen. Eloise says, really? That's a justification request. Now, this connects to the norms of the social media already had. She's blocking the addition of the food to the common ground and asking for a further claim, which is going to justify the original claim. And Abelard says, oh, sorry, there 5 minutes ago. And Eloise says, okay. So when Eloise says, okay, now both of those other claims are now in the common ground. And she's kind of accepted that and they go on. On the other hand, good luck, escalates in the kitchen, Eloise says, really? Abelard says, sorry, there 5 minutes ago. And then Eloise says, you sure? He's been in the study with me for the last half hour. I was just checking with him. Okay. So at that point, the thing that Abelard was offering as the justification is itself denied. And so now neither it nor the original claim for which it was the justification is in the contract. On the other hand, that's not the only way that justification requests can go. You could accept the thing which is given as a justification, but still not grant that it counts as a justification. Take the same dialogue, Abelard says, I saw him there 5 minutes ago. And then Eloise says, yeah, but he was in the study with me 2 minutes ago. Where is he now? Fast moving by. So, granting the premise, granting the justification, but not giving him that as the reason for his conclusion, because it's undercut by further evidence. So, justification requests, whatever's going on here, we should expect this from the sort of communicative norms of assertion in the requirements to back it up when asked. Because if I give you permission for me to ask for my, to vouch for my assertion, you've got to be able to do it sometimes. You should be able to call me on it. That's a justification request. And you'll notice this can be met by doing something which isn't a logical, deductively valid argument. None of these things are deductively valid, just these conversational moves that we use. So, here's the first card of what a justification request is. Justification request for strong assertion or strong denial, because these are things to add stuff to the common ground, so they're the things that you're asking for. There are attempts to block the admission to the common ground until a reason is given. And the reason is that another assertion or denial, or perhaps a number of them, which are going to be granted or added to the common ground in order for the request to be met. But that is a necessary but not a sufficient condition. You know, I can grant the claims that are made, but still not take that to a reason asking for further right. So that's a just sort of general structure. Now, what I'm interested in is the connection between definitions and justification requests. Because I take the rules in the logical calculus to be definitions. I'm allowed to do that. Put a DF in them. They look like a way of introducing something in a defined sort of way. And I'm interested in the interaction between justification requests and definitions. So here's my little variation of the Achilles and the tortoise dialogue. Achilles is doing some geometrical reasoning and says, this is an equilateral triangle. Tortoise says, I'm sorry, I don't follow my own friend, I've not heard that word before, what does equilateral mean? And Achilles says, ah, it's easy to explain. Equilateral is same sides of the same length. An equilateral triangle is a triangle, all of them, all the three sides are the same length. Tortoise says, okay, sounds great. You may continue with your reasoning. Okay, well, as I was saying, the sides of this triangle are all 1 cubit in length, so it's an equilateral triangle. Now, imagine the tortoise saying this. Perhaps you'll forgive me, I still don't follow. I grant you that all the sides of this triangle have the same length. I fail to see why that makes this an equilateral triangle. Could you explain why that is? Now it seems that we've got a way of understanding the particular definitions. If I accept a definition that A is just defined as B, then I should accept granting A as meeting a justification request for the assertion of B, or denying A as meeting a justification request for B's denial, or vice versa. And failure to do so is a sign that I'm not actually grasping the definition or complying with the definition. I'm not mastered, I just need practice, or something less than deck, depending on what was going on, who can tell. Now, I reckon what goes for definitions of that form goes for defining what's in my sense. Now, if you type this to be a definition for logician's negation, then it's equally a mistake to grandstand your grandbaby and look for something more to discharge any justification request for an assertion of A and B than an assertion of A and an assertion of B. If you don't grant that as a justification request, you're not following this definition. Which is not the same thing as saying that asserting A and asserting B is out of bounds just when the assertion of A and the assertion of B is out of bounds. This is something more. This is the connection between the assertion of the components and the other things in context of justification requests. It's a different thing. Connected to assertions and then, of course, different. Same for, conditional like this. It's a mistake to rule A in and rule B out and look for something more to discharge a justification request for the denial if A then B. Which is what it says on the DIN. I'm defining if A then B is denied in terms of the assertion of A and denial of B. Now, that's not what's going on in the topics of the Achilles fiber. Because they're not denying the conditional. They're using the conditional as a premise in a reason. So if we're building a work, this is where the fun comes. This is where the connection to bilateral and lateral reduction comes too. Here, I'm going to say that sequel calculus could be understood not only in the flat way that I have been understanding things, but in a way where there's a focus that is put on a particular component in the sequel. You can think of the sequel as just telling you don't assert these guys and deny those guys. Another way of thinking about it is you can put this focus on one spot and say, okay, given that you've made commitments about all of the other stuff, this by itself is going to give us an answer to this. Where that thing is the focus. So think of the first thing here, saying, if I have already granted as an assertion, ruled in A and B, then if somebody else asks, hey, what about A plus Z? You just refer back to that original point. Then we'll say, well, yeah, well, why do we grant that? Now, that might be the question. We might be trying to take that back from the common premise. But, if it's been granted, you can refer back to whatever we did there. So with the premise of telling us that in a position in which A plus Z has already been ruled in, we've got an answer to the justification request for A plus Z by referring back to then applying the conditional definition, we see why it makes sense to say that we've got an answer to the request concerning such assertion in a context in which A implies Z and A have both been ruled in. In particular, in granting A implies Z and A, we've settled Z positively because it's denied ruled out whenever, because asserting A and denying Z is turned out to deny A implies Z, or we've just asserted. Now, here's the one that was a very quick example of. A derivation of the sequel. That's what the proof is there. Where there's a focus on a particular spot on the right-hand side. Shows us how a means of justification request for the assertion of that thing that we have to focus on, given any available position in which we make the commitments concerning the other side. In any position where we've at least asserted all the X's and denied all the Y's. And they're going to be the things that we'll need to refer back to meet this justification. And standing forward, the focus was on the other side. Except now it's going to be meeting justification requests for the denial. Because we've settled negatively. Adding it positively will take us out of that. But not only that, we've got an explanation of why that is in terms of meeting justification. It's a derivation that shows us how to meet the justification request rather than the mere existence of being out of bounds with the validity of the signal. Now, in the handout and on these slides, there's a bunch of examples of, a way of annotating sequent derivations with following a focus spotlight. This says, if I've already granted A, we've got an answer to the question why A. And if I've already ruled A out, I've got a question, answer to the question why not A. These are the fun ones. Put a hat on the cases where we're doing, irrelevant weakening. Now, why do I have an answer to the question, why B, in cases where I've already asserted and denied A? Well, it's because it's why I had that writer that said that this is going to work in any available position. Turns out it's not an available position of already have the fuel supply. But the cup rule here turns out to be really easy to understand. Because one way of understanding this is, you know, imagine we're in a background position where I've asserted X is denied Y, and I'm asking the question why it's meant to guess. I already know why A is yes. I've got some justification for that. So I can answer the question why A. And now, well, since I've got A, I add that to the package of other things that I've got and use that to answer the question why B. So now I've got an answer to the question why B. And so, this direction, which is why not. Now, I said contraction. I love contraction. It's really excellent. Now, this is the one which is going to come back on. Because now, although these are sets of sentences, I could be having I in the background as one of the things that I've committed to, and now I'm wondering why it's not true. Do you mind? Well, this is how reductive it works. If I want to refute I, one way I can do that is suppose A is the case and then refute it. If A manages to rule itself out even when it's the case, then of course it doesn't. But the dual happens here. Suppose I want to prove A. Well, then try and leave it out, and if it comes back, what is there all the time? That friend that we're trying to avoid. So, it turns out that with all of those structural rules, you get this nice thing which says that the primitive derivation of ways of moving the spot around. But there's ways of connecting this to defining rules in a very natural sort of way, where you just have to focus on the thing defined below the line and focus on one of its components above the line. And, you know, some of this should look completely obvious to you, like this is, now, how do you prove a conditional? Add the antecedent to the stack of the commitments freely. And suppose that you've now got an answer to the question why the constant. On the other hand, you can do the other one, which is rule out the constant and refute the antecedent on the basis of that. That's another question. And you know, how do you refute the negation? Well, one way to refute not is to prove I. Seems really simple. But these are interesting too. How do you prove A or B? Well, try, you know, deny B and then proving A, that'll do it. Or deny A and prove B, that'll do it too. How do you refute A and B? Well, assume B, refute A. Or assume A, refute B. That's perfectly acceptable. So, but this tells you that in a principal kind of way, coming out of these norms, why dialogue, when it comes to this way of meeting justification requests, involves these other sorts of moves, which we call supposition. What's supposition? It's kind of evidentiary free addition of stuff temporarily to the common ground, positively and negatively. To answer the justification request to A implies B, what do? We try A on, get an answer to B. Or rule B out, refute A. Now, in the handout, I decided to attempt to do a difficult case, which is, you know, all of these defining rules give us all the classes, that's proof versus law. Here's a focus, Tiemann derivation of versus law. And in the handout, there's a really horrible artificial dialogue involving Abelard and Eloise, where Eloise says, if P then Q, then P, then P. And Abelard says, why would that be the case? I don't understand that if you left associated conditionals with you, please convince me why that's the case. And then Eloise says, well, let's suppose if P then Q, then P. And let's answer the question like P. And then they're gone. But as in the midst of that dialogue, there's a third partner called CG, who just tells you what common ground is in each stage. You know, what that bloke thing will be, what that bloke thing will be about. You see in the dialogue the common ground shift under suppositions and the discarding of suppositions. Until at the end, what you have is Abelard and Eloise both friends, what it was that you needed to justify. Because they're meeting justification requests. just using the rules that we have. So the handout's really bad rendering, perhaps I've gone on. No, I don't think there are any good renderings, because it's a terrible thing to try and do. Now, what we've got here in that dialogue is answers to, does this force Abelard to grant this sample? No, of course. Abelard can say, well, I don't take that to be how you justify conditionally. But then we've got a principled reason, at least, for saying that, well, okay, it turns out that, you can't put that. You mean something different. You know, the point of having these findings is that you don't lose things. Where, say, for the purposes of discussion, one of the beaut things about having defined connectives in the logical calculus is that we can be precise about what those semantics are, what the rules are, in particular, how we justification costs. And so there you have the kind of fixed point for a lever in which we've got options. If you're granted the definition, then this is going to count as a meeting of the justification cost. And if you don't allow that, then you're not complying with the definition. So I think that's an advance. So I reckon I've now got ways of answering people's questions about my interpretation. If we understand the conclusion of a proof as a formula that requires a justification request, that's right. One thing is under the focus. We can see why that kind of thing is single. But that's not to be identified on the right-hand side of the single, or the left-hand side of the single, because the kinds of things that we might want to justify can both be assertions or denials. And this single conclusion, as it were, could occur on the right or the left of the single. And the background, common ground, are things that we ruled in and ruled out, and that's the other kind of ground that we get in the single. So the single is like this. Yeah, the making of an inference, we can prospectively or preemptively answer a justification request. It's not only answering the question when somebody asks. When I say P is so Q, then I'm not only asserting P, asserting Q, I'm also in advance saying, if you're going to ask me a question about Q, P is already the answer that I'm going to give you in a justification request. And the derivation of a sequence. Now, this tells us what a proof does, rather than just the existence of some parameters. That's a procedure for meeting a justification request for an assertion, or a denial, appealing only to whatever something is. Okay. Now, and I think this is important because the bounds by themselves can transcend that class. Is Galois conjecture denial out of bounds with respect to our commitment to the analytic? I don't know whether it's out of bounds or not. Who knows? But the derivations that we have are ways that we can enforce the bounds and grasp them. The negative view of the bounds is seen in the clash between assertion and denial. They say, don't go beyond them. But sometimes we find ourselves beyond them and not sure whether that's a place that we should go. The derivations are way more active. Where we have a handle on, here's one way where we can get from some basic fact about what's out of bounds to other facts, and these are given in defining rules. Now, not all, I don't think that the if that was in Achilles and the tortoise's dialogue was a material condition, it was given in defining rules of bounds. You've got to have some other story, but it gives us a handle on where we might answer, where the tortoise would go on there. Because presumably, when you think about it, it's going to have something to do with what if means. Because if, when the tortoise and Achilles were saying this, when they used the word and spelled if, that were meaning or, then the tortoise is right to balk at this. So it's presumably got something to do with the meanings of what it is that they're saying. So what is the meaning of the if that was in Achilles and the tortoise's vocabulary? Presumably it's going to have some connections with justification across the value. And everybody's going to have an answer to that question. But this is a way of saying where the answer to that question might ask. I don't know what they mean. They were just using the word if. I know what the material condition is. Okay. So, adopting defining rules like this, one way to be very precise about the norms governing the concepts for the defining. problem to a bank. And their connections with justification requests gives us a nice way of showing not only that the bounds are kind of safe for these things, it's like, you know, we're not going to destroy the bounds of the primitive vocabulary by adding new logical concepts that are conservative, but also there are ways that are kind of practical, including that.